Africa, the biggest advertisements that you see in South Africa are either from the banks or from the big telcos. They have plenty of money to spend because the prices for a phone call within the country when you use a mobile phone are extremely expensive. It's something like 60 US dollar cents, or I guess something more than one real for a local call from mobile phone to mobile phone, even within the same provider. So the idea came to place that we should do something about it and do something for communication similar to what the One Laptop Per Child project was aiming at doing for the education of children. So we want to revolutionize the way people communicate. In Africa, mobile phones are very popular, probably the same like here in South America. People spend more than 50% of the disposable income for mobile phone services in Kenya. You even see Maasai that have mobile phones. Basically everybody has a mobile phone today, and people spend a lot of money for this service. So the Schattenberg Foundation, Steve Song, he called upon a group of experts, including me, to sit down and make a workshop to explore the probability to develop something that Steve Song calls the village telephone. A DIY kit so people can build their own telecommunication networks based on license-free Wi-Fi. So I'm not going to read that slide to you, but yeah. So the idea was to make this toolkit consisting of a hardware that we have here now. This is now the production mesh potato, as it is manufactured by a company called Atcom in China. The sales price at the moment is around $100, but we hope to be much cheaper, so of course it depends on the quantities. Yeah, and of course we need a fancy logo, so that became the logo of the village telco. During the workshop, people were holding two devices together. What you see on the right hand side, it's relabeled in Venio, but it's actually the same device that Meraki sells, or used to sell. It's a Meraki Mini. It's a mesh, little mesh router for Wi-Fi, and on the left hand side you see an analog telephone adapter that you can use to connect analog telephone to an IP-based network. So the idea came to be that we make a fusion of those two devices.
Genealogical, maybe.
And so the name was born. The network topology that we favor is mesh networking, real mesh networking, like multipoint to multipoint ad hoc networking. It integrates mesh networking with the plain old telephone system, which is usually referred to as POTS. And it has an ATA, analog telephone adapter, so hence the name mesh potsata was made converted to mesh potato. So that's how the name came to be. So out of the idea of holding two devices together, it was the vision created to have something that integrates both. Then we tried to prove the feasibility of that approach with the same chipset that we wanted to use. Actually, what you see there is a hacked D-Link DIR300, which uses the same Atari's chipset that is now used in the mesh potato. So we added an FXS, an analog telephone adapter interface to it, to see if it's feasible to do this. And then a company called Atcom, they produced the first beta run of these devices. About 160 have been produced in a CNC machine housing, quite expensive. And finally, we're back now this device in an outdoor enclosure, which is low power. It's especially designed for developing countries. So if you abuse the device, like feed the wrong voltage or the wrong polarity into any of these ports, it will not work, but it will survive. So once you re-establish a working connection, it will still work like before. Well, I know there are many free network guys here that know everything about mesh networking by now. But for those of you that don't know it yet, we favor mesh networking, which is based on the ad hoc mode of Wi-Fi. When you use Wi-Fi, usually you have a hotspot that your client device connects to. Without a hotspot or an infrastructure device that you can connect to, your device is useless, like a mobile phone. If you go to Iceland, into an area or somewhere in Brazil where there is no coverage of the GSM network, the device is useless. You can use the torch maybe, you can build a torch or the GPS, but you can't make phone calls. So what you actually need, or what we figure is important, is the ability to communicate peer-to-peer directly out of central instance. Well, unfortunately, my screen is a little cut off. On the right-hand side, the last gray dot that disappears, it's a node named B, and it cannot communicate with the rest of the world. It would be in the wireless range of A, but since all those devices are running in infrastructure mode, B cannot communicate with everybody else. In ad hoc mode, on the other hand, all the peers can directly talk to each other as long as the wireless range is sufficient for a direct point-to-point communication. So in our example here, A can talk to C and B, but A, for example, cannot talk to D and E. Well, that issue is solvable if we just install a routing protocol, especially geared for the requirements of Wi-Fi, into the boxes. The result is that everybody can communicate with everyone. The system is based on mutual aid. Each node acts on demand as a relay station for everybody else. Therefore, you have a network that can grow to a vast size, and organically and dynamically, and if some node goes down or breaks, the routing protocol will establish an alternative route if it's possible. Just to give you an idea of what it can look in practice, this is a cut-off of the network topology of the 5G mesh in the year, I think, 2006. It's only a fraction of the whole network. We have about 600 to 700 nodes running all the time. And you see, it's possible to do much more than just interconnect by a device. So the vision is that the mesh potato is deployed in a township like here Township in, I think it's Johannesburg. You put them on the roofs. They will interconnect each other. And everybody can connect a phone into its device. And now, for the first time in their lives, they have a landline phone. And a landline phone number, which is also very helpful in getting a job. Because if you apply for a job and you only have a mobile phone, people think, you're probably a poor person living in the township. So the goal of the project was to develop a technology model that can be used and deployed quickly. And people said, I'm just a technology geek, people said we need a viable business model to make this sustainable. A business model is more sustainable than just a community network. Well, some people here in this room would object, and I, of course, like a community approach. I was told, hey, we need to provide the means to start a little business with a reasonable time for the return of investment. So the model is like, somewhere we have an internet access point. We erect a super node. Here, picture in the center, you see three panel stations. They have a sector-like radiation pattern. So you can use three different channels and have three different sectors for your central node. And away from central node, you have the mesh potatoes distributed, and they all interconnect. And if the range is not sufficient to talk directly to the super node, then the mesh kicks in and automatically relays packages so everybody can communicate. Part of the system is A2 billing. It can be installed on the server. We have Ubuntu packages for the recent versions of Ubuntu, and this will installed a billing system where you can create brochures, you can set the rates and tariffs and choose the design. And actually, we have already deployed this type of systems in several places in the world. At the moment, the test networks are rather small, like in the range of 30 to 50 devices. And in Connecticut, there is a provider operating something most of IP units. It's called LABA, and we use the Orange Park in the township 40 kilometers outside of Johannesburg. These are the equipment. When you deploy a device, it's important to note, you can power it by several different power options. Because some people will only use it for telephony, you can also power it from the telephone cable, or the power over telephone line. And actually, the little black box that you see in the center of the picture, it's the adapter for power over telephone line. So up to 20 meters, you can power the device just by connecting the power to the telephone cable. And of course, it supports PoE, and we also have the DC support. Core software components of the Mesh Potato itself is the OpenWRT embedded Linux distribution, which is a very nice meta distribution that you can use to make your own firmware run. We use the Red Hat bootloader, which is made by Red Hat, which is also open source, and we use the Batman Mesh Routing protocol, but if you wish